right? So work holding device, so is a given word. Work holding devices again into categories into different, like lathe center, chucks, face plates, right? So mandrels, steady followers, lathe drafts, all these things we only briefly discussed last class. So now we are going to see what are these work holding devices as well as what are these tool holding devices, right? So these are the work holding devices. So various work holding attachments such as three jaw chucks, collects and centers can be held in the spindle between the two centers. So whatever the things we are seeing on the lathe, so which is used to hold the workpiece. So in that basic thing, basic device, whatever you can see on left side, you can see there is a rotating member, right? Which used to have some three kind of pins or three kind of jaws are there. So that is called as a check. So actually that portion, that device, that work holding device, which is using to hold the workpiece is called as a check. So in that check, you're having a different number of jaws are there. Jaws are nothing but, so which is used to hold the workpiece, right? So that is three jaws will be there. Jaws are nothing but if you see in our mouth, so whatever we used to call this upper portion and lower portion is used to call as a jaw only, right? Using jaw only, we are holding anything in your mouth. If you want to put your brush in morning or maybe you need to eat something, what you're doing, you're holding using this jaw only, right? Whatever the teeth, upper layer of the teeth as well as the bottom layer of the teeth, nothing but it is considering as a jaw. So similarly in work holding devices, here we having a two jaws in mouth, but there we have to have three or four jaws will be there. So if it is three jaws to hold the workpiece, it is called as a three jaw check. If it is having four jaws, it is considering as a four jaw check. So that's only, that is simple, that device is called as a check. If it is a three jaws, we used to call it as a three jaw check. If it is a four, that way we can see in the next slide. So what are the jaws? So in addition to jaws, there is other work holding devices are there. So normally for parts with very high length, so length is not smaller, it's very high, then we are using some kind of centers. So we're using centers in this lathe. So three jaw check also called as the self center check. So that maybe I can explain to you in the next slide. So mostly three jaw checks are using for holding the symmetric work pieces like cylinders, hexagonal or maybe octagonal, like that symmetrical work piece normally we are using in the three jaw checks. So, and also there is one more holding device called collect. So collect normally using to hold only cylindrical work pieces, that two very small diameter like pins or maybe small diameter rods like 10 mm or less than 10 mm diameter rods. So those kind of things, whatever are holding, those things we used to call as a collector. So maybe the next slide we can see each and everything. So maybe I'm going for next slide. So checks. So checks are nothing but these are the check. So this kind of things maybe you can see in your lathe. So this is nothing. This is whatever the portion is there. So this used to called as a check, right? Here there is a pin is there. Maybe here is not visible on this surface. We having a pin. So in that pin, if you rotate that pin, so what happened? These jaws can move forward as well as a backward. So if it is a smaller workpiece, so you need to move in one direction. So these jaws will move forward and it is holding the small workpieces. If workpiece is bigger, then what we used to do? You need to rotate this pin in other direction so that these jaws will be going in this external direction it will go. So if you want to have, if your workpiece is bigger than this, then what you need to do? Your jaws has to move outside. So these jaws has to move this side, right? So this side when it is moving, so these jaws are shifting. So it is coming in this direction so that even big object, a bigger diameter objects also, you can keep it in this. So these three jaw checks normally hold for round and hexagonal. So round as well as hexagonal work pieces. So nothing but it is using for symmetric work pieces. So whichever the work pieces are there, if it's a symmetric, we are using these three jaw checks. So the three jaw checks move simultaneously. So whatever the three jaws are there, so once you rotate one pin, so these whatever the jaws are there, so these jaws are moving simultaneously at a time. We not need to move this jaw separately, this jaw separately, this jaw separately is not possible to move. In three jaw checks, so all the three jaws are moving simultaneously. If something is moving backward, so all three is moving backward. If something moving by 10 mm, so all three jaws is moving 10 mm only. So it is simultaneously used to operate. So jaws move simultaneously when adjusted by the check wrench. So whatever the pin I told you here, so this pin used to called as the check wrench, right? So this, when you're rotating this one, these moves are is moving forward as well as the backward. So normally this grabs the work quickly and accurately without any deviation. So 1000 means 10 power minus 1 deviation to even 1 inch, even small deviation also is not permissible. So whatever the distance it is moving, same distance all these three checks are moving. Because it's moving simultaneously, then whatever the holding is very fast it is holding. If it is not simultaneously moving, for example, this is moving simultaneously, this is moving separately, then what happened? Each and everything you need to move accordingly. First you need to rotate this pin, so this is move forward, then you need to rotate this check, so then there is here one more pin is there, so this pin when you are rotating, this move forward. Means this process is taking very long time if it is not moving simultaneously. Because it's moving simultaneously, that's why work piece whichever is holding in this jars is doing very fastly. So very small, without any deviation, so all the three jars are moving. So coming to be four jar check, so in this three jars are there, that's why you used to call it as a three jar. So here this is also same thing, only you having a check only here also. So in this check you need to, you see here three jars are there, but here you can see there is a four jars are there. So that's why this check is to called as a four jar check. And here maybe you can see on this surface there is, you have seen some kind of hole. So in this hole you can keep that pin. So whatever the pin is, you can discuss wrench, whatever we can discuss about wrench. So this wrench is coming here. When your wrench is fitting here and you're rotating, so these jars are moving forward as well as the backward. So here normally three jar checks is also called as a universal check. So here all things are moving simultaneously, but in four jar checks, so each jar is moving independently. It is not like simultaneously like this. It is independently. If you want to move this check, you need to rotate this pin. If you want to move this, so here one more pin is there on that surface. Really, here one more on the surface, one more pin is there. So here in surface, one more pin is there. So these pin in four jar checks always it is used to call as an independent check. Any questions? So four jar check
is used for irregular objects, sir.
You first let me complete. I have not explained completely four jar check. After completion, if you having doubt, you can ask me. Four jar check is independently it is moving. So here in three jar check, it's moving simultaneously. That's why we used to call it as the universal check. Whereas here in four jar check, so each jar is moving independently. That's why we used to call it as the independent check. So in this independent check, any kind of object, even if it's a symmetric object or asymmetric object, any object we can insert here. So here we told you the grasping is faster, but only symmetrical object only we can keep. But some work pieces are not symmetric. Asymmetric work pieces are there. So which work piece is not symmetric? Those kind of work piece we can insert in this four jar check. So this is independent check, generally as four jars which are adjusted individually on the check face by means of adjusting screws. So whatever the screws are there, so these screw wrench we used to call. Whatever the wrench is there, if inserting in this screw, and you can rotate. So normally irregular shape of workpieces can be holded in this check. So here only circular or hexagonal. So in addition to circular and hexagonal, we having lot of other cross section of workpieces are there. For example, a cam is there, right? So cam is not a regular surface. So cam is not possible to hold on three jar check because of uneven surfaces or nothing but unsymmetric surface. So that kind of surfaces normally we used to use in four jar check, right? So somebody is asking question, please repeat your question now. So I hope your question is clarified. So in four jar check, independently each jar is rotating, is moving. Whereas in three jar check, it's simultaneously moving. Because of independently moving four jar checks, whatever the workpiece, whether it's a regular workpiece or irregular workpiece, any workpiece can be held in this four jar check. So three jar check, actually most popular check is three jar check only. Four jar check only for specific applications whenever is required. So in that cases only we are using four jar check. Otherwise three jar check is more popular. So whatever you can see in your lathe, almost you having it, more than 10 lathe machines are there in your machine shop. In that all 9 lathes we having a three jar check, only one lathe we has to have four jar check. That also only peculiar work pieces we want to machine, at that time only we are using that four jar check. So three jar check hold round and hexagonal works, what we already shown. Three jar move simultaneously when adjusted by the check wrench. Grasp work quickly and accurately within few centimeters or few inches. So the advantages of the universal scroll check or universal check is easy to operation, because within by moving, you see here this is the wrench, whatever you seeing pin, by rotating one, so all these things is moving simultaneously. So you don't want to worry, by doing one thing, you all three moving simultaneously means your process is faster and more accurate. So normally for general purpose we are using this only, your three jar checks. So anybody want to note down, please note down, otherwise you can take the screenshot. I will go for next slide. So three jar checks is more popular, and 75% to 80% of our lathe machines we used to use three jar checks only. Can you go for next slide? I'm going for next slide. And there is one more other. In addition to checks, 3-jar checks, 4-jar checks, there is one more device called collect. So this is a typical collect. This is used to called as a collector collector. So this in this what is the here you don't have the jars. You have some kind of flexible arms are there. So these three flexible arms are there. So here by putting this screw arrangement, by tightening the screw, so these three jar checks will be tightened. So these come together. If it is unscrewing this one, so these jars are creating some kind of small clearances coming here. So in this, normally these kind of collectors are using for smaller work pieces, not for the bigger work pieces. Maybe you can see some kind of pins, some kind of maybe less than 10 mm, even not less than, even less than 5 mm diameter of the rod, whichever is required. So for that, we are using this kind of checks, this kind of collectors. So this used to called as a collect check. So normal because it's similar kind of principle of check. That's why also called as a collector check. So collector check normally, if you see, take in your pencils. So not this wooden pencil. So normally you can take pen pencil. So in that we used to insert a lead. So that is same principle. Whatever the lead you are keeping, so lead maybe diameter is something about 1 mm diameter. So in that whatever we are keeping in the pen pencil, so look like a pencil, but used to have a pencil. Look like a pen, but used to have a pencil. It used to, we need to insert some kind of leads. So those collectors are this kind of things only. For small cross sections, we are using this. And there is one more special applications we are using magnetic checks. So magnetic checks normally just by inserting here, by keeping your workpiece on this, because of magnetic force in this checks. So under magnetic force, so your workpiece is firmly gripped on this surface. So normally magnetic checks are using only for the ferromagnetic material. So normally for thin jobs can be held by means of a magnetic checks. Normally using for thin jobs or maybe smaller jobs, we are using magnetic checks. But we are using only for ferromagnetic material, which can attract to the magnetism, those material only we are using. So other material like aluminium, if you want to use, or copper is there. So those material normally we are not using magnetic checks. So then coming to be mandrels. So sometime what is there, we used to machine hollow surfaces. So hollow material like pipes are there. So high thickness pipes are there, those kind of thing. So for that, we used to use this kind of mandrel. So this is whatever you're seeing in the blue color is the mandrel. And whatever the green color you're seeing, this is actually workpiece. So what we will do, we just insert this workpiece, whatever the hollow workpiece is there, that hollow workpiece insert on this mandrel. So this mandrel is fixed in your spindle. And this is rotating. When you insert this workpiece, so this workpiece, which is the hollow workpiece, is firmly placed on this mandrel. So this is a solid mandrel. So in this you have some kind of taperness is there. If you apply some small force in this direction, then this will be go and sit on this tapered surface. And it is firmly grip on that. So as spindle rotates, as the spindle rotates, is rotating this mandrel. So as the mandrel rotates, so because there is no relative motion between this workpiece and mandrel, there is no clearance. It's firmly grip on this. So as this rotates, as this mandrel is rotates, blue portion, so this green portion also start rotating. So then you can do whatever the operations you need to perform. Similarly, mandrels is there. Actually, there is a three different kinds of mandrels are there. So this is used to call as a solid mandrel, only single mandrel, so mounted on the spindle. And there is one more called as a gang mandrel. So in gang mandrel, normally for multiple works, multiple work pieces has to machine simultaneously at a time. Maybe you have to have some 3-4 different sizes of plates are there, or maybe different sizes of plates, or maybe flat materials are there. So now you see here, so you're having 1, 2, 3 different kind of plates are there. So all three different kind of plates are mounted simultaneously on this gang mandrel, and you are performing the operation, we're cutting the material. So for normally gang mandrel, so similar to your solid mandrel, only thing other side, one side and other and both sides you used to have screw and washer will be there. So nothing but this is called as sleeve. Some sleeves are attaching and some bolt, from bolt and nut, we're using some nut, we are tightening the workpiece. So what are the workpiece are there? It's tightening because it's a gang mandrel. We are machining more than one workpiece at a time. If you don't clamp it properly, if not having this nut, tightening the nut, what happened? So these pieces may have slide from this. To avoid this sliding, so we used to lock this. That's why we used to have some clamping mechanism. This is nothing but a clamping mechanism. And also there is some kind of cone mandrels also there. So especially if you're having some countersinking holes. So like holes are not, here holes are a cylindric hole. But sometimes we used to have countersinking holes also required, especially to accommodate some kind of special equipment to accommodate. We used to have this kind of countersinking we are providing. So in this kind of thing, we used to have the cone mandrel. The cone mandrel is nothing but here you see, whatever the sleeves are there. So the sleeves are straight or nothing but it's a vertical. right? But here it is not vertical, like having some kind of taperness is there. So because of taper, this used to be called as a cone, taper mandrel or nothing but cone mandrel. So these are the mandrels. Normally mandrels are using for holding the hollow work pieces. So previously checks, collectors or magnetic check, all these things are using for solid work pieces. But mandrels are using only for hollow work pieces, not for the solid work pieces. So then coming to the centers. So this, whatever the checks are there, so checks are using at one side. So maybe left side of the workpiece, which is holding. Checks are using to hold the workpiece, right? If it is a small workpiece, last class we have seen, if workpiece is smaller, so which is length is somewhere about 100 mm or 200 mm. So directly you can mount it on the check and you can start rotating. And you can remove the material from that rotating workpiece. But in sometimes your workpiece is very longer. Maybe your workpiece is somewhere about 500 mm, half meter to 1 meter, or maybe even 1.5 meter. So in that much long workpiece when you use your machining, what happened when you're rotating this? So because of there is always some micron level unevenness may be possible in the material. So because of the unevenness in micron, so when at this particular end, when the check, at the end of the check to at the end of the workpiece, there is a small deviation also happened. So at the end, maybe possibilities are there. Your workpiece may bend at free end. To avoid this, to avoid the bending or to avoid any kind of things, we used to provide a kind of support at the free end. I hope in mechanics of solid, you studied about cantilever, right? So whatever the workpiece we are inserting in lathe is nothing but it's just like a cantilever, right? So one side you are holding on the workpiece in the check, and other side it is a free. So what happened when cantilever, when free end is there, what happened when it is rotating at very high speed, then there is a possibilities of bending or nothing but deflection is possible in the workpiece. To avoid this kind of deflections, we used to provide some kind of support in the second end also. So that kind of support is provided by so these kind of centers. So maybe whatever you're seeing in this picture. So this is nothing but this typical center. This is called as a center. So here you used to have some small sharp end. So this sharp edge is in touch with the workpiece at the other end of the workpiece, maybe 1 meter, 1.5 meter, or maybe 500 mm. So it's give, and it's giving some kind of support to them. So now whatever previously workpiece is held only in check, it used to act as a cantilever. But when it is used to introduce one kind of support at the other end, so it's become a simply supported beam or nothing but you can see the fixed beam. It's become a fixed beam. It's fixed between the both the points. One is check and one is at the tailstock. So in tailstock, we are assembling these centers, right? So if you fixed beam, if you consider both fixed, both ends are fixed, then your workpieces become more stronger. So even you can apply more force. There is no, even if you're applying the more force, there is no deflection happened in the workpieces, right? To avoid this kind of thing, for especially for long workpieces, normally we are using this kind of centers. So work to be turned between the centers must have center hole drilled on one end. So what happened here? One side of your workpiece, maybe you have the check which hold it on the check. But other side, you need to have this kind of center. So normally centers has to have some sharp edge to avoid a sharp contact. So what we used to do, so whatever the workpiece, for example, this is your workpiece, right? Just I'm drawing in horizontal direction. So maybe I'll remove this. So maybe if you see, so some horizontal direction workpiece is there. May. So just assume your workpiece is very long. So like this, right? So like this workpiece is there. So this workpiece is held in a check in this direction. And in this direction, because it's very long, we need to provide some kind of support. This center we need to keep. What we'll do, we'll keep center like this, right? So center like this. So and then this is like this. This is a tailstock. So this is the center is mounted in a tailstock, right? So what happened in this case? So what happened when, if it is a very sharp, there is a stress concentration will happen. To avoid that, so what they will do? So normally we used to do some kind of small hole we are making. So what we're doing here, we're doing a small hole. Now it's not through hole, it's very small hole. So maybe small hole of maybe 500 mm depth with some diameter. Radius is not important, some radius, maybe 5 to 10 mm radius and 5 mm depth hole we are making. Then what happened? So this center, whatever is there, it is going into the workpiece up to here. So it's not only here, it is coming inside, right? Like this, maybe I'll cut this. So I'm cutting this. So maybe this is there. So now what happened? Whatever your center is there, the center can easily so penetrate into this one. So like this, your center is coming like this. Means it's going inside. So maybe you're touching with this edges, right? Here like this. And it is from here, it is coming like this, right? So like this center is there. Means it is contacting this much surface. So previously it's contacting only one point. Now you're providing because of making a hole, so you contact in this much portion. Means area of contact is increases. So as area of contact is increases, stress in the material is decreasing. So this is we have not, and also it is increasing the grip also. If you're providing single point only, so touching, so grip is less. Now you have contact point of this one. So then this point contact length is very, actually this is nothing but periphery of this, whatever the cone portion. So if you say this portion, so complete periphery, this whatever I'm drawing, it's a front view. Actually, if you see this view, so this is nothing but a circular periphery. So nothing but this portion. So this portion you used to have very big contact area. So because of high contact length and contact area, stress concentration can be reduced. So it also supporting during cutting, because at the end, this end it is providing, so it is giving some kind of support. Most commonly, so whatever the include angle is there, so this angle whatever is there, this is providing 60 degrees. Most popularly, whatever the centers are there, so this included angle is giving us 60 degrees. And mostly it is using of, this material is made of steel only, stainless steel. And some, this is stainless steel only completely, but in some centers, which is using for high strength materials, so in that case, this whatever the tip is there, so the tip is normally made of carbide tips. So carbide tips are fastening or nothing but welding on this, so that it is not easily wear. So what happened when this material is coming in directly contact with the workpiece, there is a possibility if it is a weak material, its strength is not less, what happened? So the material at this particular point may possible to wear out. To avoid that, normally we are using the high strength tips are using. So carbide tips or maybe even sometimes ceramic tips are using. So these are about centers, lathe centers. So lathe centers normally keeping in tailstock. So then coming to be surface plate. So previously we have seen check, right? So checks normally what happened? It is it used to have three or four jaws. So three or four jaws are moving outside and it is holding the workpiece. So normally in that, so at a time we can hold only one workpiece, not more than that. So but sometimes we used to have holding more than one workpiece and also workpieces of different shapes, different sizes. So different workpieces having different shapes and sizes. For that, normally we are using this kind of plates. So in this, maybe you see this is lathe. This is a headstock. So on the headstock, instead of check, you have this kind of arrangement. So in that, you see center there is a hole, and here maybe we having some kind of slots are there. So in these slots, we are inserting some kind of bolts, and whatever the workpiece is coming, so the workpiece we are holding here, or even your workpiece can hold it in this portion also. So in this portion also we are holding. So you're just putting some bolts here and holding workpiece here. So like this, we can hold a multiple workpiece on this. Not a single workpiece, multiple workpiece can be hold. So this kind of plates used to called as a surface plate. So surface plate, this is a small surface plate. So here also you can see it's a very big surface plate. A very big object if you want to machine, so we need to have a surface plate which having a very big in size. So you see, this is here you can see this is the door, right? The door is somewhere about 6 feet if you assume. So this is more than 6 feet. Almost this is something about 8 to 10 feet are there. 10 feet height or nothing but 2 meter height is there. 2 or 3 meter height is there. 3 meter height. So this much big as well as this much small. So both can be possible to make on surface plate. But only thing, in checks we used to have jaws. So using jaws, we are gripping the workpiece. But here you don't have any jaws. So what happened? Along with this, you used to have some extra attachment to hold. Even if you're having a big workpiece, even if you have to have small workpiece. So small workpiece, if you want to make it here, so we get keeping the workpiece here, and here you can put some kind of bolts or nothing but sometimes we used to keep some kind of dogs. So lathe dogs, last class I have discussed about lathe dogs. So lathe dogs normally used to use along with the surface plates. What happened? These lathe, so this is a typical lathe dog. So these lathe dogs, whatever is that, this is a bended lathe dog and this is a straight lathe dog. So ironically, this lathe dog used to have some kind of threading at the end. So these lathe dogs normally keeping in this, so in these holes, and it's tightening. And outside, this is mounting on the workpiece. So these are typical lathe dogs we are using. So normally, this is a lathe dog which is using for circular objects or nothing but round workpieces. So lathe dogs normally using along with the surface plates. Without surface plate, we are not using lathe dog. Lathe dog is using to mounting the workpieces through this. In this, maybe you can pass the workpiece and just hold it. So available with square heads. So here, maybe you can see in lathe dogs. So nothing but this is nothing but also a kind of jaws only, right? Whatever 3 jaw checks, 4 jaw checks. So this, whatever the bolt is there, so this bolt is acting as a jaw. If it's moving in one direction, it is moving forward. If it's moving other direction, it's moving backward. If you want to keep one object here, for example, some circular object, you need to keep it here. You have to keep it and you need to tighten it. So if you tighten it, so in between this surface and this bolt, it is firmly gripped on the surface plate. And when this dog is rotated, which is mounted on the surface plate, your workpiece also is rotating. So this is a typically straight lathe dog, and this is a bent lathe dog, a cross lathe dog. So driven by stud in driver plate. Even sometimes we need to provide the studs also. So this whatever the portion is there, you used to call as a stud. And also you can put some kind of threading here and you can extend this. So even if you want to have big work pieces or long work pieces, maybe you can extend this. So normally lathe dogs are using to hold the work piece along with the surface plates. So then these are the few work holding devices, right? So now coming to be tool holding devices. So these in this lathe dog, surface plate, checks everywhere, what we are using to hold the workpiece. But in addition to workpiece, we need to hold the tools also. So these are the typical tool holding devices. So after tool holder, this used to called as a tool holder. So in the tool holder, we used to have three different kinds of tool holders are there. Left hand tool holder, right hand tool holder, straight tool holder. So left hand tool holder means it's offset to the right of the edge. So actually it's bent towards the left, but it is offset towards, if you take that whatever. So this is the cutting edge. So this is the cutting tool actually. This is the cutting edge. So this is your body of the tool. So this body of the tool is after offset towards the right. If this is bent to the left side, so cutting tool, if cutting tool is here, so its body is somewhere about right side to this cutting tool, right? That's why this used to call left hand tool holder. So left hand tool holder, it is left to bent towards the left. So designed for machining workplace close to the checks. So when this kind of things are there, so this is nothing but your offset to the right. So means it's bent to the left. So when it's bending to the left, it is machining the portion which is close to the check and face plate, check or face plate. So it is cutting it right to left. So normally it is cutting from right. So from this, if you take this here, so we having a headstock at the right side and tailstock at the right side and headstock at the left side. So normally you used to go for this direction. From headstock to headstock. Normally we are using left hand tool. So this is left hand tool is marked by L. L, a symbol L is given, normally used to embedded on this tool. If it's giving L means it's a left hand tool, normally used to cutting from right to left, nothing but your tailstock to headstock.
Sir, I have a doubt, sir, in this.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, how it is fitted on a...
No, you see, so this is your here, there is a bolt is there, right? So if you unscrewing the bolt, you can remove this cutting tool. So this is the cutting tool, this is the tool holder. So this cutting tool you can insert here, and you once you unscrew this and you can insert the cutting tool. Once your cutting tool is tightened, so these complete setup you are keeping in your tool post. So we discussed about tool post when discussing about different parts of lathe. So in tool post normally what happened, so this used to have this kind of arrangement will be there. So in base, so you used to have some kind of plate, right? So plate is there. So this is mounted on your tool post. So on your cross slide is tool post is mounted. So this kind of things are there. So this is a hollow portion. So this is a solid portion, right? Just I'm trying to hatch this. Just I'm trying to hatch it, right? So here you used to have some kind of bolt will be there. Right, some kind of bolt is there. So this portion, whatever you are seeing, this one, this is inserting in this. So in this, this is inserting here and tightening with the bolt. So this is the tool holder. So this is the tool. Tool is mounting on the tool holder, and tool holder mounting on the tool post. So this is called as the tool post.
Sir, tool post is slowly sliding as
which one? Which one?
Tool post is slowly sliding, no, sir, towards the
tool post is holding the tool. So if this tool post is moving this direction or this direction, so along with this tool post, your tool is moving. When you're giving a feed, for example, you're giving the feed from this direction to this direction, you're moving. So this tool post is moving this direction. When tool post is moving this direction, whatever it is holding tool in this, so the tool holder and tool, so this is also moving in this direction. If tool is moving, then only you can remove the material in that particular location. Right? Left it is not sliding. It is moving. Sliding and moving, there is a difference there. So sliding means normally what you there is a relative motion. Here you are having a carriage, right? So this is mounted on a carriage. So as carriage is moves, so as, along with the carriage, your tool post is moving. As tool post is moving, inside the tool post, you are having this this check. So this tool holder. This tool holder also moving along with that. Right? It's not slides. It is moves. So maybe yes. Some books it's mentioning as sliding also. Sliding is nothing but motion only. But normally sliding means in our physics, what we learn, sliding in physics or mechanics. So sliding means above the one object, other object, if it's slipping, there is a relative motion, then we can call it as a slide. For example, our piston. Maybe if you can see on road, vehicle is tire is sliding, right? It is moving. So road is stationary and the wheel is moving. So that is called as a slide. But here not sliding, right? It's completely moving. So along with this, it is moving. So it's not called as a slide. It's nothing but a movement. So this is the left hand slide, right? So left hand tool holder, and similarly there is a right hand tool holder, just quite opposite. So one side this direction, left direction. If it is a bend, left hand tool holder, offset to right. If it is a bend to the right side and offset to the left, then it is called as the right hand tool holder. So right hand tool holder normally marked by symbol R. So designed for machining work close to the tail stocks. So normally what happened is opposite direction to that one. Whatever the previously we have seen left hand. So opposite to that one. Previously it is machining from tail stock towards head stocks. So machining is very close to head stock is doing. But using this, because this is bent other direction. So normally machining is done close to the tail stocks. And cutting normally happened left to right. So means from head stock to tail stock normally machining is happened on right hand offset cutting tool. So these are the two tool holder, and then third tool holder is a straight tool holder. So in straight tool holder, there is no bend at all. It's completely straight. This is the tool holder, and in this, whatever the hole we are seeing here, we can insert a cutting tool. So previously, maybe you can see left hand tool holder, right hand tool holder. There is some kind of bend is there, but here there is no bend. Normally, this is using for general purpose. So normally using for the plane turning operation, we are using this. So used for taking cuts in either directions and for the general machining operation. So for plane turning, normally we are using so this kind of straight cutting holders are using. So then coming to a turret lathe. So turret lathe, maybe I can discuss after the break. Now we can go for still 3 minutes time is there. If any students having any doubt in work holding or tool holding devices. So anybody have any question in work holding or tool holding devices? Anybody want to note down? I'm going back to the slides. Please note down. If you want, I will give you the time. So this is the work holding devices. This is our first slide for today's class. Right? If anybody want to take this screenshot, please take the screenshot. If you want to note down anything, you can note down. So anybody want to note down, please note down, otherwise take a screenshot. We discuss about different types of lathes. But in that, one of the type of lathe is turret lathes as well as capstan lathe, whatever we have seen. So I told you later, we'll discuss about in detail about turret and capstan lathe. So this is a typical turret lathe. So maybe you can see it here. So you see this is a turret lathe. So this is similar to whatever the lathes we have seen in last two classes or just now class, whatever we have seen, the same thing, right? The same thing. So here, this is main important parts if you take. So this is the headstock. So this is the bed, right? So and this is the carriage. So both are in the different plane because this is a three-dimensional, two-dimensional. That's why we're seeing both are same. But actually, your headstock is a little bit away from tails, this tool post or nothing but your carriage. And here, used to have a tail stock, right? In normal lathe, but here in this peculiar machines, the tail stocks are replaced. So here, if you say this is another tail stock, so this is tail stock is replaced with this kind of attachment. This is some kind of hexagonal. This used to called as a turret. So this kind of lathes used to called as a turret lathe. So because hexagonal, this whatever the tail stock is there, so tail stock is replaced with an turret. So hexagonal turret or sometimes circular turret or sometimes you having a square turret also you're using. So this is looking like a hexagonal turret. So hexagonal turret is there. So remaining things are same. Only thing, so instead of tail stock, you're having a turret. And accordingly, turret operating mechanism is coming. So previously, lathe if you say, so this kind of wheels or this kind of arrangement is not there. So now this kind of arrangement is come to control this turret. So normally in turret lathe, the process of operation is faster. So here, because in each, whatever the hexagonal turret you're seeing, so this is a typical hexagonal turret. Maybe this is, if you want to see this, this is a typical turret. So tail stack is replaced with this kind of turret. This may be circle or sometime maybe you having a sides also, straight edges also there. So each edge used to have some kind of machine, some kind of tools or is that some kind of cutting tools. Maybe some kind of drill bits or maybe some kind of reaming tool or some kind of cutting tools. All these things are mounted at each side. So because of this, what happened here, production rate will be faster. Because in previous case, whatever the tool is there, we are mounting tool is on the tool post. Last, just now we have seen the tool holder. Inside the tool holder, we are keeping the tool, and this tool holder is mounting on a to on tool post. So mounting on a tool post. So that we have seen, right? So in the tool post, we are mounting only one tool at a time. If you want to change one tool to other tool, for example, you are doing a plane turning. You are using plane holding tool holding device, right? So plane turning. If after plane turning, maybe you want to go for some kind of thread cutting. So in that, what you used to do, you need to stop the machine to remove this cutter, and then you can keep the thread cutting tool you need to insert. So this process is taking time. It's a it is time consuming. So in between the operations, you need to stop the machine and to replace. For that, maybe some time is wasting. To avoid that, scientists have invented a new method. So in that, what they used to make. So this whatever the tail stack is there, so tail stack is replaced with some this kind of turret, and also tool post. So whatever the previously single tool post is there, so those tool post is replaced with the square turret. So here also replacing with a small turret, here also is replacing with a big turret. So this tool square turret is nothing but is a square shape. So you used to have four sides. So each side you can mount in one workpiece, one cutting tool. So like this onto square turret, you can keep four tools. As well as here, you having a hexagonal turret. So here you can give each side, you can keep it six sides, so six tools. So six tools here to four tools here means at a time six operation we can perform without stopping the machine. So without stopping the machine. So maybe it's not doing simultaneously, but one after other without stopping the machine, maybe you can take it and you can do it. So you can machine. So machining process is faster. So if any students having any doubt, please ask me after end of this session. At the end, 10 minutes I will give you. At that time, maybe whatever the slides is missed, I will go back to that slide. Now you can continue here. So like this kind of lathe is called as a turret lathe. So capable of performing multiple cutting operation on the same workpiece. So what happened here? You having a turret, right? Square turret, and here you having a hexagonal turret. Means one tool from here and one tool from here. two operation you can perform simultaneously. For example, you are making a drilling of this hole at the end. So drilling as well as the turning, both can be happened simultaneously. Similarly, once the plane turning is over, if you want to go for thread cutting, then what you need to do, not need to stop the machine. Just you need to press this, whatever is there here, when some extra attachment, the turning tool, turning handle is attached. If you turn that handle, similar to this one, there is one more handle is there. If you attach this one, so this, whatever the tool post is there, is turned by 90 degrees. So previously, whatever the tool exposing to here, so this is come side, and whatever the tool in this direction, that is come forward and ready to cut the workpiece. So like this, so whatever the idle time to replace the cutting tool can be reduced in this turret lathe. So turret lathe, so all the operations, whatever the operations we discussed previously in lathe, all the operation can perform without stopping of the lathe machine. So turning operation, boring, drilling, thread cutting, facing, so all these operations can perform on this. So turret lathes are very versatile type of lathes. So it's consisting of a turret. That's why this lathe is called as a turret lathe. So in that, maybe next slide, if you go. So this is a typical turret lathe. Turret. So these machines are capable of carrying out multiple cutting operation on the same workpiece without stopping of machine. So several cutting tools are mounted on the tetra, penta or hexagonal turret. Even sometimes tetra, nothing but square type of turret also we are using four side. Penta, even five sides also you can use. So how many sides, that many number of cutting tools you can mount in on this turret. So several cutting tools are mounted on the turrets, tetra, petra or hexagonal turret, which replace the tail stock, right? The tools can be rapidly brought into action against the workpiece one after other or one by one by indexing the turret. So indexing is nothing but you're rotating. Once you rotate the whatever the mechanism is there here, whatever this is there, once you rotate this, so this portion, whatever, for example, your cutting tool is mounted on this side. So this is going the other side and this will come forward. So like this, one after other six operation you can perform without changing the cutting tool. So by doing this, productivity is increasing and manufacturing time is reducing. So because there is no idle time. So this is typical turret lathe. So this is a headstock and this is a typical turret. Maybe you can see here. So this is the turret. So on this, different cutting tools are mounted. And this is the wheel. So whatever the things are there. So this maybe you can see the handle. So by rotating this, you can change this cutting tool. I mean cutting tool orientation you can change. And one more important lathe is there. That's called as a capstan lathe. So capstan lathe is only same to the turret lathe. but only difference is there. So normally whatever the turret is there, so it is turret is mounted on a crossbar. So in this crossbar we can move forward and backward. There is in turret lathe you can mount it on the tailstock. In place of tailstock, what are the guideways are there. So in the guideways this is using. So in this it is mounting on directly on the crossbar, whereas in turret lathe the turret is mounting on your direct on saddle. So normally turret lathes are very strong, robust in structure. For heavy work pieces normally we using turret lathe. For light work pieces normally using capstan lathe. The main differences of turret lathes and capstan lathes are is given here. So turret lathes, this is one of the important questions may come in your final exam. So difference between turret lathes and capstan lathe. So in turret lathes are relatively more robust and heavy duty machine. So turret lathe is a heavy duty machine, work on checking type of the jobs held in the quick acting checks. Normally in turret lathes workpiece is mounting on the checks only, right? So we are keeping the check. Whereas in capstan lathe, so normally you deal with the short or long rod type of the workpiece. It means nothing but it is not heavy work pieces. So light work pieces normally used to use in capstan lathe. So turret lathe, the heavy turret being mounted on the saddle, so directly mounted on the saddle, which directly slide with the large stroke length of the same bed. So what I told you, so this whatever in turret lathe, so turret is directly mounted on the saddle and this saddle is moving in your guideways. So directly on the bed it is moving. There is a capstan lathe, it is not moving directly on the bed. There is some crossbar is there. So on that crossbar, the capstan lathe turret travel with a limited stroke length. It is traveling on the cross land within a saddle type guide blocks called auxiliary bed. So normally for capstan lathe, we used to have a auxiliary bed, which is nothing but cross beam we used to call. So an auxiliary bed, the turret is moving, which is clamped on the main bed. So whatever you're seeing in the capstan lathe, so this is a little bit sideways, not on the guideways. So there is some auxiliary bed is there. So on the auxiliary bed, we used to mount in the capstan lathe. That's why normally capstan lathe is not using for heavy work pieces. So in addition to guide rods, our pilot bars is provided on the headstock of the turret lathe to ensure the rigid axial transfer of the turret head. To making the rigid, to make the work the machine to be more robust, more rigid. So this directly your workpiece directly you're mounted on the headstock, and headstock can get directly can rotate. So external threads are generally cut. So on this capstan lathe, so external as well as internal threads can be possible to cut. The single point or multi point chasing tool being mounted on the front side of the mood by a short lead screw. So whatever the things you are using in this, so by moving this, so maybe you can make the external as well as the internal threads. So similarly in here, so in capstan lathe also external screw threads are cut in capstan lathe if required using the self opening die being mounted on the one face of the turret. So whatever the dies are there, so dies are normally mounted on the turret faces. They're mounting on the turret faces and they're used to make the external as well as the internal threads. So major difference between the capstan lathe to turret lathe is normally capstan lathe we're using for light job and turret lathe using for heavy job. So what are the objects we are manufacturing? What are the objects we're machining in? Normally using the big object for turret on turret lathe and small objects on capstan lathe. So I want all the students has to note down these points. So this is one of the important question will come in your final exam. Differences between turret lathe and capstan lathe. So note down this, otherwise you maybe take your screenshot. So I want everybody to note down these points. So that's why I'm giving one more minute time.
For a previous slide.
Yeah, previous this slide, right? Take this slide.
Yes, sir.
So discuss about automatic lathe also, automatic as well as the semi-automatic lathe. So normally automatic, when we read further more productivity, so further we need to stop the wastage of time, then we can go for semi-automatic lathe. So semi-automatic lathes are production lathe with minimum human involvement, only for certain operations, only for loading, unloading. Except loading, unloading, there is no human intervention is there. In turret lathe, what we have done, so we used to replace tailstock with the turret. In the turret, we used to, at a time, we used to carry 4 to 6 cutting tool at a time. So without any stopping the machine and without changing the cutting tool, we are performing all the 10 operation one after other, right? But human intervention is there because changing the tool has to done by human only, right? In turret lathe. But when it's coming to be automatic lathe, So even that that things also is done by man only, done by machine only. Even for changing or rotating the turret also performed by the machine. That's why these machines are called as automatic machine. But in this machine, whatever the machine you are seeing, semi-automatic machine, so all the operations is performed by the lathe only, but loading and unloading has to perform by the operator. That's why this is not called as the automatic machine. We used to call it as a semi-automatic machine, because human interference are nothing but your operator's interference is decreased, but still loading is unloading done by operator only. That's why these two used to call it as the semi-automatic lathe. So wide range of jobs can be accommodated, higher production rate is increases. So production rate is more. So as normal engine lathe are nothing but center lathe to capstan lathe, productivity is increases. Capstan lathe to semi-automatic lathe, further production rate is increasing. Because here everything, even for changing of the tool, rotation of turret, everything is done by machine only. The productivity is further increased. So suitable for drilling, countersinking, reaming, tapping, like operations. So making drilling is nothing but making some kind of holes. Especially for making holes or maybe internal features. So these semi-automatic machine is very much useful. So turret and capstan lathes are some kind of example. Similar to that one, this will be there. But even the turret and capstan lathe, similar to turret and capstan lathe, but even turret and capstan rotation, whatever is there, that also performed by machine, not by operator. So this is the extension of turret and capstan lathe, we can say. So then coming to the automatic lathe. So in whatever the drawbacks are there in semi-automatic lathe, so that we can overcome in automatic lathe. So in automatic lathe, what we're doing, even that loading and unloading. So it's a typical automatic lathe, maybe you can see in this here. So here, so in this, maybe you can see this is a typical automatic lathe. So in this, even loading, previously what happened in semi-automatic machine, so tool changing, machining, different types of tool introductions, everything is done by machine. Only operator has to do loading and unloading of the workpiece. Once you keeping the raw material in the chuck and tighten the chuck and switch on the machine, so all operations has performed by the machine only. Right? Once the job is done, then machine stops. You need to reopen the chuck and then remove the workpiece, remove the work your object. Whatever the object is ready, you can remove and you can insert a new workpiece. And new workpiece again is continue the process. But in this automatic lathe, even for removing and inserting of the workpiece also done by a machine only. So manual machine control replaced by various mechanisms here. So cam mechanism, different kind of mechanism we are replacing. What we need to do, we need to keep a sequence of workpieces. We need to keep it in somewhere. So automatically the machine is take the workpiece one after other. Once workpiece is, job is completed, first job is completed, it will remove the workpiece from the check. And the check automatically the other workpiece going and sitting in that previous workpiece place, and the process is continue. So what happened in automatic machine, just morning when you come to, when you open the shop or you open the workshop, just switch on the machine. So everything is done by them. Only you need to, operator has to take care. There is a sufficient raw material has to available with the machine. So that only has to take care. So other all the operation, even loading, unloading, removing, machining, lubrications, everything is done by the machine only. That's why this used to called as the automatic or nothing but fully automatic lathe. So manual machine control replaced by various mechanism. So parts are fed and removed automatically. Whatever the semi-automatic machine is there. So inserting or keeping the workpiece and removing the workpiece is done by manual. But here that operation also is done by machine. So may have single or multiple spindles. So in this automatic lathe, so whatever you're seeing, normally whatever we have lathes we have seen. So here what we used to have, only one single spindle is there. So one single spindle and this spindle we used to mount in.
This automatic machine is there in our lab, sir?
No, we have to have some demo machine is there in our CNC lab. That is CNC machine. CNC machine also one kind of automatic lathe only. So that CNC machine is extension of automatic lathe. So all operations are performed by the lathe only. Plus programming you need to give through computer. So not need to give any kind of switches or pressing is not required. Just you need to keep all the information through the computer. Just like you need to create a program, so on that program you can feed into the machine. So completely machine is follow whatever the program you are given to the machine. That's why that machine is called as a CNC machine. So computer numerical control. And this is automatic machine. So here operations, commands, everything is given by a panel. So for example, this is a panel, right? From this panel you need to give how much feed, how much depth of cut, how much feed is required. So all these things you need to give from this panel. Whereas in CNC machine, so completely controlled by computer. So CNC machines are there in our workshop, in our CNC lab. So here, because this is completely controlled, so productivity is already increased and there is no human interference there. So here the possibilities are there. You can keep even multiple spindles. So not single spindle. So in capstan lathe, in central lathe, as well as in semi-automatic lathe, you used to have only single spindle. I mean, at a time, only one operation is performing. But in this automatic lathe, when you're making automatic, so maybe you can keep multiple spindles also. In addition to one, in place of one spindle, maybe you can have a six spindles. So means you can have the six jars, six checks will be there. Six checks is holding six different objects. Means simultaneously, you can produce six different products. Like that, multiple spindles also can be possible in automatic lathe. You may have single or multiple spindles. So automatic lathes are used for servo motors. Normally, they use the servo motors. So about the servo motors, maybe you can study it in your fluid mechanics. So servo motors normally run by fluids. It's very, very much a robust mechanism is there. So this is worked by servo motors. So automatic lathe, limited range of variety and sizes. But only thing here, automated lathe, so very big size of the object we cannot make in automatic lathe. So because in automatic lathe, maybe you having everything is done by automatically. So without any interference of human. In that case, the automatically feeding and removing of work pieces for big sizes very difficult. So that's why normally for small to medium work pieces can be made in automatic lathe. So that is one of the biggest limitation in automatic lathe. We cannot manufacture big surfaces. So what are the features of automatic lathe? These are the few features of automatic lathe. So minimum manpower utilization. So obviously there is no human interference there. So one, just you can switch on and switch off only, that is there. And you need to be take care about the proper raw material has to be available. So minimum manpower utilization. So mean for mass production. So mass production, nothing but in a very huge quantity of objects we are manufacturing. That is used to called as a mass production. So these things maybe you can study in your production planning and control. So mass production means just remember. So when you are making huge quantity or very big number, thousands or maybe some lakhs of objects we are manufacturing. So that kind of process is called as a mass production process. So that production is called as a mass production. So normally in automatic lathe, because we used to have multi-spindle and very fast operations, normally production rate is very high. In 1 hour, you can manufacturing some hundreds of objects you can manufacture. So depending upon size and type of the workpiece, the type of the final object. So manual machine control replaced by various mechanisms, eliminate the amount of skilled labor. So most important advantage of automatic lathe is there is skilled workers requirement is not there. So skilled worker means even a fresh worker or fresh engineer, experienced engineer, both can perform same way. Because finally, so operator involvement is very less. Only thing they need to switch on and switch off. So operator skills are not much requirement.
Sir, yes? Skill operator are not required in this machine.
Yes, right? In automatic lathe machine, skill operators is not required. So you see what you're doing in what operators perform is role here. Just simply switch off the machine. Then end the switch off the machine. I need to take care of raw material, proper raw material has to be available. So this anybody can do it, right? So skillness is not required. So when you're using capstan lathe or maybe using the general central lathe, in that case, because you need to give feed or manually you're controlling feed, depth of cut. So how much feed need to give, how much speed you need to control. So all these things will come with the skillness of the operator, skillness of the worker. So these things are required in there. But when automatic machine, everything, speed, feed, depth of cut, all the parameters, everything is taken care of by the machine only. So human interference is less. That's why even unskilled worker can use this automatic machine. That's why you see when this automation is happening.
In semi-automatic machine, skillness is required.
Skillness is required, not up to that much. Actually, for central lathe and turret lathe, you used to have highest skillness. So as automation is coming to picture, skillness is less. So in semi-automatic machine also, skillness is not required, but you need to have an operator who can change the workpiece and change the tools. Those things are required. So means you need to have some kind of operator who need to have at least know how to change the workpiece. That information means that skillness is required. Other skillness, feed, depth of cut, those skillness are not required. So normally for semi-automatic as well as automatic, skillness of the operator is not required. In automatic, still that is also not needed. So even a person who's a normal person can operate the machine. So that's the only thing that is happening, right? When you're going for automation, so your process is going to be simple and simple. So human work is going to be simple and machine is taking care of everything, right? So that will become easy. So if you take in your car also, you need to have a gear as well as the gearless cars are there. If you need the gear car, what you used to do? You need to change the gears every time. If it is a gearless vehicle, so what happened? You not need to worry about changing of the gear. Then the smartness or nothing but your alertness during driving is a little bit come down. right? You not need to change the gear. If you take just school, you just take your two wheelers, moped, scooty, and your bike. Maybe you whatever the bike you are running. In bike normally we used to have gears. Whereas in scooty or maybe Activa, we don't have the gears, right? So all gears are inbuilt gears are there. So once you raise, you give the accelerator, vehicle will start moving. But in bike is not like that. You need to raise as well as you need to change the gears as per your speed requirement. So skillness is more skillness is required for the gear vehicle. Whereas non-gear vehicle, even a basic who knows the driving, he can drive. Even if you know the cycling, so you can drive the scooty or you can drive Activa. But for driving the bike, you know the gear changing, right? Similarly here also. So in normal central lathe, we used to have the worker who know all the things. Whereas in automatic, as the automatic lathe is come, so even just only switch on and switch off. If somebody know how to switch on and how to switch off the machine, so he can do the process, right? So skillness is decreasing. It's not know anything. Only switch on and switch off is required. So skillness is decreasing. So skillness is not required in automatic lathe. So mechanic is enabled to following certain prescribed frequencies. As per the frequencies, we need to run. So parts are fed and removed automatically. So minimize the loading and unloading time, because everything is done by machine. So time for the loading and unloading is decreased. That's why productivity is increasing. So may have single or multiple spindles. Tool setup may be permanent. So sometimes what happened, whatever the tool setup is there, that permanently you can mount on the turret. So whatever the 6 tools on the turret and the 4 tooth on the tool post. So all these 10 tools you can permanently keep there. So as per your final component you are manufacturing, because if you're making a mass production system, mass production, so completely, because once you load the tools, it will because it's, you need to manufacture hundreds and thousands, even sometimes millions of products you need to manufacture, right? So that's why tool changes is very less in automated lathe machines. So may have horizontal or vertical spindles. Even for vertical spindle, this is whatever you have seen, the central lathe is everything is horizontal, right? So spindle is moving about horizontal axis. Even you can use the vertical axis also. So means like vertical axis, and your tool is rotating in the vertical vertical plane. So more accuracy can be obtained, because everything is automated. So everything, more accuracy is come. So advantages, limited, these features and advantages almost same. The same thing is repeating here. So greater production over a given period. So production rate is increases as it become automatic. So what are the advantages you are going to get finally is, so productivity is increasing. Production rate is increasing. In same time, so whatever, for example, if you take in one day, so how many number of components you are manufacturing in your central lathe? So almost 10 times more you can manufacture on this automated lathe. So means production rate is increasing. So more economical in floor space, because it's actually automated machine. That's why the area it occupy on the shop floor is less than central lathe. So normally central lathe is very robust structure. So whereas an automated lathe is small in size. So improvement in the accuracy, surface accuracy is increases on the workpiece, floor space maintenance and inventory requirements are reduced, more consistent, accurate work than turrets. So compared with turret and capstan lathe, the accuracy of the workpieces is higher in this. So more constant flow of production, scrap loss is reduced by reducing the operator error. So previously what happened when you're using operator, if some kind of error is happened because of the operator, so the work is going, whatever the workpiece is there is going to be scrapped, that's going to be waste. Those kind of things you can reduce here, because automated, there is no operator who is coming in morning and working for 8 hours. So in that conditions, then worker is coming in the morning and one worker is doing the same work continuing for the evening. His concentration, his consistency is not constant. So morning he is very active and he is without any errors he is doing. But is when he's going to be up to 4 o'clock, so that whatever his concentration level is decreases, because he may lose his patience because of continuous working. So similarly, if you take the students who is coming in morning, so morning whatever the subject is coming, you listen very interestingly. So as time goes on, so morning, after that you're going for lunch, and after that again you're coming back to the class. So as you're going in evening and evening, your concentration level are nothing but your interest for the subject is decreasing, right? So this is obvious. So similar kind of thing is happened for the operator. So normally what we used to do in the studio for students, normally morning time we used to keep the lectures, afternoon we keep the labs. Because even if you're not having much concentration, not much, but if you're going to the lab, maybe you can by performing some operations or performing some experiment, whatever the concentration is there, that can be, you can continue your concentration by going in the lab. That's why most of the cases we see, morning you used to have the lab, used to have the lecture, and afternoon you used to have the lab to avoid this kind of things, and as also to increase the concentration of the student. So whereas in shop, the worker who is working, he cannot do like that, right? So he cannot work morning while going, he's working on one machine, and evening you're going for some other machine or somewhere else. It's not possible for him, right? So that's why normally the production rate as well as this errors, what are the possible by workers, that is possible in manual operated machine. There is an automated machine, those kind of errors can avoid. So more constant flow, scrap loss during the machine operation, operator is free to operate another machine. So one more important thing, in automated machine, I told you only switch on and switch off is sufficient. So here, so one operator can be parallelly or simultaneously can work on multiple machines, because what he need to do, his role is nothing in that, only he need to switch on and switch off. So one operator, when you coming in morning, he can work all the 10 machines at a time, all the 10 machines are working simultaneously. If it is a manual machine, so all 10, each machine needs to have one operator. 10 machines require 10 operators. If it is automated machine, 10 automated machine is required, only one operator, right? You only just want to switch on the machine and you need to see the operations, how the operations are going on. That's all you need to do, right? That's why when everything is going automation, so human requirement or nothing but employment is decreasing. This is a major concern for today's manpower, as today's workforce or today's engineers. If everything is going to be automation, so engineers' requirement is come down. So now you need to be very active in your subject as well as in your experience, so that whatever the things are reducing, so in that way, other things you can concentrate and you can make expert in other activities like programming. If you want to go for automated machines or CNC machine, so in that we need to have somebody who can program properly, who can give proper inputs to the programmer, right? So like that, you need to be refresh yourself. Then only you can sustain in the market when it's going to be automation. So even I told you, the automation machine used to have single spindle as well as multi spindle. So this is a typical single spindle automated lathe. So in that you can see only one spindle is there. So this is a spindle. At a time you can mount only one workpiece and one workpiece only you can machine. Whereas in multi spindle, this is a typical multi spindle lathe. So in that each thing, whatever you're seeing, these are the spindles. So you have four spindles here. So four spindles, four workpieces. Similarly, four cutting tools are mounted. So four cutting tools simultaneously you are mounting. So capstan and turret, similar to capstan and turret lathe, on tool post as well as on turret, you having a different kind of tools are there. So like this, you see in multi-spindle lathe machine. So at a time you can produce multiple product, multiple work can be possible to do on multi-spindle machine. So multi-spindle automation machine, there are 2, 4, 5, 6, 8, like different sizes of different number of spindles can be available on a lathe machine. In contrast with the single spindle machine, where one turret face at a time, the working on the spindle, where is that only? Single spindle machine is nothing but similar to your center lathe, right? Whatever the lathe we have discussed. Only multi spindle lathe we use to mount in at a time. Different work pieces you can mount and different operations can be performed. Simultaneously different operation, not on the same operation. Even somewhere in turning, somewhere is drilling, somewhere is taper turning, somewhere is plane turning. So any kind of operation simultaneously can be possible to perform on this automated lathe, multi-spindle automated lathe. The single spindle, which one turret face at a time, like production capacity is higher, machine accuracy is lower compared to the single spindle. That only, sometimes what happens, because in single spindle, so the machine is focusing on only on the one operation. That's why accuracy is very higher in single spindle. In multi-spindle, because what happens sometimes, one workpiece, not directly but indirectly, maybe it can influence on the other workpiece, or maybe one cutting tool may be affected by other cutting tool. That's why accuracy, it is little bit less, but accuracy is always more than the semi-automated as well as your center lathe. Because of long setup time, increasing the tooling cost in this machine, but only thing, because automated lathe is there, so initial setup cost is little higher, because all the 10 tools are maybe all the whatever the tools are there, so these tools has to set up, so initial setup time is more. That's why initial setup tooling cost is higher. So normally in automated lathe as well as the multi spindle automated lathe, initial investment is higher. So this few explanation is there about multi spindle machine. So in this type of machine, same operation is performed on the each spindle. Workpiece is finished in each spindle at one work cycle. So it means that number of components being machined is equal to number of spindles. How many number of spindles are there? So that many number of components can be made in one time. In at a time, you can manufacture this many number of objects. So obviously, rate of production is still increased in multi spindle lathe machine. Single spindle lathe machine, you are manufacturing one product at the standard time. So now you can make how many spindles are there, that much rate of production is increases. The machines are usually automatic cutting a bar type machine used to perform same work as a single spindle automatic cutoff machine. Same kind of operations are performing, but only thing that many number of more number of machines can objects can be manufactured. So machine consisting of frame with headstock at right end. So all these things are similar. So whatever the center lathe is there, similar only there. Horizontal work spindle that are arranged to above another are housed in a headstock. So one above other. So whatever you've seen in this, so one above other. This completely headstock if you take. So in that, so this many headstocks will be there. So these are total head. So if you say here, so each thing is, this is total headstock if you say. So in the total headstock, so you need to have this many spindles. So multiple spindles, 1, 2, 3, 4. Four spindles are there. So different kind of spindles are there and different kind of works can be possible. Even this is a typical multi-cylinder, multi-spindle engine. So multi-lathe, this is one spindle. This is one spindle, this is one spindle. So each spindle you are mounting a check. Similarly, you need to have a turret. So on that maybe you can have different kind of tools are there. So different kind of work pieces as well as different types of tools are there. That's why your production rate is increasing very high. So this is nothing but six spindle progress actional automatic lathe. So single six spindles are there. So three spindles here and behind this three more spindles are there. So this is the typical automated lathe. Maybe this, maybe you can do, these things are there. So machine headstock is mounted on the left side. Same thing as there. I think this is the same thing is there. So this maybe this slide maybe you can skip this. So right. So 3 minutes are left out. So I'm stopping the tool layout and time calculations. Maybe you can see in the next class. So with this, just I'm stopping for today's topic. So just I think some 40 minutes lecture is left out. The 40 minutes maybe I will take up in next class about the tool layout as well as time calculations. If possible, we can discuss one or two problems in next class. So anybody having any question, please ask me now.
Indexing direction in here.
Repeat. Right. I'm not able to hear you.
Indexing direction.
So indexing direction is nothing but you see on which direction, whether it is a clockwise direction or the anti-clockwise direction. Indexing is nothing but in turret, when you're rotating, so this the turret is rotating about some particular angle. So direction is nothing but whether it is rotating in the clockwise direction or in the anti-clockwise direction. So based upon that only, because you need to have a six surfaces, six cutting tools are mounted on the turret. If you're rotating one direction, so you are going to get one cutting tool. If you're rotating in other direction, you're going to get other tool is coming for cutting. So that rotation, whether it's a clockwise rotation or anti-clockwise rotation, that used to called as a direction of rotation. For example, this is indexation direction, this is only. So if you're rotating this, for example, you're machining. So this is one cutting tool is there, right? So this is machining on this workpiece. If you're rotating this direction, so this cutting tool is coming forward and machining this workpiece. If it is the direction is this opposite to this one, so whatever the cutting tool is there here, so this is coming and cutting this. So depending upon your operation, which operation you need to perform, you need to rotate in that particular direction. So this is calling it as a direction of rotation, a direction of index of direction. So indexation is nothing but rotation. Right? So any other question is there?